You have seats empty next to you. I would like to ask, if possible, if you could scoot to one side or the other. We have other people in the back. We want to make it as easy as possible for them to find a seat. Please and thank you. And for those of you who are in the back, we'd just like to invite you to come as close to the front as possible. It'll be much easier for you to hear, and we don't want you to miss anything. This is going to be an exciting session this afternoon. A few announcements. Children, we have some children here. Children 4 years old and up, there is going to be a hike taking place. You can meet upstairs with Miss Daphne. The children that are younger than that, we would ask that the parents accompany their children on the nature hike. So you can still meet upstairs with Miss Daphne, and she'll be leading out in that hike over the course of this program until about 5:30. Additionally, I just want to introduce some of the participants that we have in the program this afternoon. Charissa Fong has been sharing her messages with us this week, and she will be sharing a message entitled Power On. And she has come here to be with us from Australia, works at the Adventist Media Center there, and has been sharing some powerful messages. Amen? Amen? And so we look forward to that very much. We also have some special guests with us here over in this corner, if you all would like to wave. The Wildwood Strings, they're going to be blessing us with some lovely music this afternoon as well. And then we are also going to be having a Q&A, and I just want you to be mentally prepared for this Q&A. We have several of our ministry missionaries and leaders that are going to be answering questions that you may have about the life in supporting ministry work. And this is going to be open floor. So we just ask if you have a question when we come to the Q&A time, please wait for the microphone to come to you, and because we want to make sure that all is heard well and that's all on the recording. So that's the program for this afternoon. We do want to begin with a word of prayer before we go into the music, but before we do that, just a reminder, if you wouldn't mind turning the Wi-Fi off on any of your devices, that will really help with the sound system and with the streaming. If you don't mind just turning that off, that would really be appreciated. Let's bow our heads for prayer. Heavenly Father, we are blessed to be able to fellowship together on your Sabbath. With the sun shining and the blue sky and just the amazing weather and good Christian fellowship with our brothers and sisters, we want to thank you for the gift of this day. And we want to invite your presence as we are here gathered together this afternoon. We pray that you would be with us and that your spirit would speak through Charissa and also play with the young people who are sharing this afternoon. We thank you for communing with us now. In Jesus' name, amen.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. Are you still alive? Yes? Very good. We'll begin our song service by the use of the hymn 321, and we invite all of you to sing with us, My Jesus, I Love Thee. We have a big crowd today, so we would like to hear your voices as we blend together.
My Jesus, I love Thee. I know Thou art mine. For Thee all the follies of sin I resign. My precious Redeemer, my Savior art Thou. If
second stanza. Okay, man, it's our time.
I love thee in life, I will love thee in death, and praise thee as long as thou lendest me breath.
Not hearing you, man. Together, fourth stanza.
In mansions of glory and endless delight, I'll ever adorning in heaven so bright, I'll sing with a glittering crown.
God. We'll do hymn number 338, Redeemed. 338.
Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed through his infinite mercy, his child and forever I am. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, his child and forever I am. Redeemer, I think of him all the day long. I sing, or I cannot be silent. His love is the theme of my song. Redeemed by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it. Child and forever I am.
I know I shall see his beauty,
a king in whose law I delight, to lovingly guard at my footsteps and giveth me songs in the night.
Redeemed
by the blood of the Lamb. Redeemed, how I love to proclaim it, his child and forever I am.
Thank you very much.
God is good, and all the time. Amen. It's been such a privilege to be here and worship with you this Sabbath and also to be here with you throughout this week. I realized last night that I have to leave and start my journey home this evening, and I actually started feeling a little bit sad about that. I'm looking forward to seeing my family, but I feel like I've found the world as well. So thank you so much, and God is good, and I just thank him for this honor and this privilege to be here with you. My message to close this week is entitled, Power On, Little is Much. Would you bow your heads with me as we open with prayer? Loving Father in heaven, by being able to worship you today here together, and as we study the Bible once more, we invite your Holy Spirit, Lord, to be present in our midst. I pray that you would charge our batteries, that you would fully charge us, Lord. May we be inspired and challenged to dream big because we serve a big God. We love you and thank you for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name, amen. Do you ever have trouble trying to fall asleep at night? Some people said no, but I often struggle to fall asleep at night. Doesn't matter how tired I might be, my brain just won't shut down. Is it working? Not quite working. Hold on one second. It's on? It is on. See, we need more power. Is it? Shall I keep talking or should we swap it? Talking. You can hear me? Sort of. You can't. Do you want me to try that one? Yellow. This sounds a little bit better. No? That's good. Oh, now I can hear myself. All right, so as I was saying, sometimes I struggle to fall asleep at night. And one night I was having one of those nights where I just couldn't fall asleep and I was getting desperate. I tried everything. I tried counting the number of cars that drove down the street. I tried counting the number of breaths that I took, but of course I wasn't going to stop breathing, so that didn't help. And I thought, I'm getting desperate. And then I thought, I know what I'll do. I'll take out my iPod and I'll listen to one of the less interesting books in the Bible, and maybe that will just put me to sleep. So which book do you think I put on my iPod? Isn't that interesting? There are a lot of not very interesting books. You all called something different. I went to the book of 1 Chronicles, because if you've ever read that book, you will know that it is about as interesting as reading a Hebrew telephone book. So I hit play and closed my eyes as the drone of begats and begots began to sound in my ears. My breathing slowed. My eyelids grew heavy. I feel tired just thinking about it. When suddenly I heard something on my iPad, on my iPod, that literally made me sit bolt upright in my bed. And this afternoon, I want to share with you what I heard that night. It's one of the most amazing stories that breaks if you listen to the book. So here it is, 1 Chronicles chapter 4, verses 5 through 10. This is where we'll find it. It says, and Asher, the father of Tekoa, had two wives, Hela and Naara. Naara bore him Ahuzam, Hefer, Temani, and Hashatari. These were the sons of Naara. The sons of Hela were Zereth, Zohar, and Ethnan. And Koz begat Anub, Zobebah, and the families of Ahahel, the son of Harum. So you can see why I came here to this book to try and fall asleep that night. But then I came to verse 9 and it said this. Now Jabez was more honorable than his brothers, and his mother called his name Jabez, saying, because I bore him in pain. And Jabez called on the God of Israel, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me, and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain. So God granted him what he requested. Friends, there you have it right there. It always pays to be on the lookout for the obvious. Here, as I am listening to this chapter, buried beneath what seems to be a billion begats and begots is a lone shining star, and his name is Jabez. He's in the fourth chapter and 44 names into the fourth chapter. Here is where his story breaks. And the amazing thing about him is this. Everything that we know about Jabez in the Bible, it's right there on the screen in front of us. That's all we know about him. We don't know where he lived. We don't know what he looked like. We don't know what he did for a living. But we know this, that Jabez is recorded in the pages of Holy Scripture because he prayed a prayer that was so on the mark that God granted him what he requested. I don't know about you, but that's the kind of praying that I want to do too. Oh. That was an amen moment. When I do this, it means amen. That was an amen moment. We want to pray and God will answer us. And so, friends, Jabez, like everybody, he had some difficulties in his life. We know that because his name means, his mother gave it to him, and it means, I gave birth to him in pain, or he will cause pain. Now, I'm sure you're familiar, but in the Bible context, names are very important. And this is a picture of my family many years ago now. And names have always interested me. And when I was about that age, I remember talking to my parents, and I was asking them, you know, why they called me Charissa. I mean, if you didn't call me Charissa, what would you have called me? And my mom said, oh, we probably would have called you Samantha or Elizabeth or something like that. I said, okay. And I said, well, what if I was your son? And my dad said, oh, that's easy. We would have called you David because his name is David, or Conan or Tyrell, or get this, Tell, T-E-L-L. These were the characters that were the heroes in some cowboy books he read as a kid. And I praise God I'm not a Tell. Can you imagine? Tell to tell them this. Anyway, I'm just glad I'm Charissa. So as I come to the story, though, I realize that Jabez, he has a problem. And we don't know the reason why his mother chose to call his name Jabez. Maybe it was because the birth was difficult. Maybe the husband left her. We don't know. But whatever it was, he had a name that every kid would hate to have. In the Bible times, a man and his name were so intimately acquainted that when the Bible says his name is cut off, it means he is cut off from life. So imagine going through life with a name that reminded you of the pain that you had caused your mother. Imagine that. Well, in the eyes of the world, Jabez may have been a born loser, and when the world declares you a born loser, you have two options. One, you can succumb to what everybody thinks about you, or number two, you can overcome. And Jabez chose the second. How do I know that? Because it says here, now Jabez was more honorable than his brothers. Friends, he looked at how his family was living. He looked at how people around him were living. And he decided, I don't have to live that way. Some people will just keep going through the motions, but not Jabez. Some people are content to live in spiritual ruts, but not Jabez. He doesn't complain. He doesn't resign himself to his situation. He takes his burden to the Lord, and he asks God to help him. So friends, the first lesson I take from his story is we can carry everything to God in prayer. And there's a story about a man named Joseph Scriven who seemed like he was going to be destined to know nothing but the friendship of Jesus Christ. In 1840, as a young man in Ireland, his intended bride accidentally drowned the evening before the wedding. Poor health meant that he was forced to abandon his dreams of joining the army, so he moved to Canada, where there he became a servant of the underprivileged and the poor and the physically handicapped, and their tragedy seemed to follow him as well. Once again, he met another young lady. They fell in love and made plans to get married. But shortly before the second wedding, his second fiance died following a brief illness. It seemed that Joseph Scriven was destined to go through life knowing nothing else but the friendship of Jesus. In his last illness, a neighbor came to visit him. When the neighbor walked into his room and saw Scriven lying on the bed, he noticed a manuscript beside the bed. And it was something that Joseph had written to share with his mother. So the neighbor asked, he said, what's that? And he said, the Lord and I, we wrote this between us. You want to know what the manuscript said? What a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and griefs to bear. What a privilege to carry everything to God in prayer. Oh, what peace we often forfeit. Oh, what needless pain we bear, all because we do not carry everything to God in prayer. Jabez chose to carry his burdens to the Lord in prayer. No doubt he had grown up listening to how his God was a God who delighted to rescue his people, and he had rescued his people from powerful enemies. He remembered how Jacob in Genesis 35 had loved Rachel, and how when Rachel was dying, giving birth to their son, her last request was, call him Benoni, which means son of my sorrow or misfortune. And Jacob, knowing the power of a name, says, no, don't call him that, but call him Benjamin, which means son of the right hand. And no doubt Jabez had remembered how one night Jacob had found himself wrestling with an angel, wrestling with God. Jacob's own name meant cheat or heel grabber. And in that moment, you remember that God changed his name. God said, your name will no longer be Jacob, but Israel. Why? Because you have struggled with God and with men and have overcome. And perhaps Jabez, in his young mind, as he considers these things and puts the puzzle pieces together, he thinks to himself, if God could change Jacob's name, and if Jacob could change his own son's name, then God can help me in my circumstances as well. I love this quote by Eric Little. He said, circumstances may appear to wreck our lives, but God is not helpless among the ruins. Amen? Our lives, our broken lives are not lost or useless. God's love is still working. He comes in and takes the calamity and uses it victoriously, working out his wonderful plan of love. Circumstances may appear to wreck our lives, but God is not helpless among the ruins. And so, friends, Jabez prays this prayer. He's not remembered for fighting in a battle. He's not remembered for building a wall or for doing anything amazing like that. He is remembered because he was a man of prayer. And people of prayer capture God's attention. I want to just focus and step through on the four aspects of his prayer. The first thing we notice here is right here. It says, and Jabez called on the God of Israel, saying, oh, that you would bless me indeed. The first thing Jabez prays for is he asks for God's blessing. There once was a king who heard that there was a citizen of his empire who was always doing good things for other people, and he thought, I want to acknowledge him. I want to give him something because I'm so grateful for what he does in this kingdom. So he summoned the man into the palace, and he was a humble man. He came and stood before him with his staff in one hand, and the king said, I've heard what you do. And I want to give you something. I will give you one day. And you can walk around however much land in this kingdom that you can get around in one day. And whatever you get around in one day, I will give it to you. Without a moment's hesitation, that humble man before him took his staff and drew a circle around him right before the king. The king said, what do you mean? You only want what's in that circle? He said, no, your majesty. I want everything outside it. That man was bold in his request of the king. But you know what? When Jabez comes to God in prayer, he is bold when he comes before the throne of grace in prayer. He comes and he asks for God's blessing. And I hadn't really thought about this too much before until I came to this story. But we need God's blessing in our lives, do we not? If we do not have the blessing of God in our lives, in our families, in our ministries, well, then we're just wasting our time and spinning our wheels. But Jabez knew that his God was a God who delighted in blessing his people. Remember what God said to Abraham. God said, I will make you into a great nation, and I will bless you, and I will make your name great, and you will be a blessing. God delights in blessing us. Why? Notice what the Bible says here in Psalm 67. God be merciful to us and bless us and cause his face to shine upon us. Why? That your way may be known on earth and your salvation among all nations. God delights in blessing you and I so that we can be a blessing to others. And by the way, in case we think that blessings are only the good things that happen to us, I did a little bit of research and I discovered that Charles Haddon Spurgeon, he actually wrote four sermons on the subject of Jabez. Four. It's not a lot in the Bible on him. It's amazing. But in one of his sermons, he said this, what though it be a cross that raiseth thee, yet if it raise thee to God, it shall be a blessing indeed. And anything which helps me to glorify God is a blessing indeed. If I be sick and that helps me to praise him, it is a blessing indeed. If I be poor and I can serve him better in poverty than in wealth, it is a blessing indeed. If I be in contempt, I will rejoice in that day and leap for joy. If it be for Christ's sake, it is a blessing indeed. The first thing Jabez prays for is God's blessing. But he goes on. He says, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory. That's the second request he makes in his prayer. Friends, Jabez asked for God to enlarge his sphere of influence for him. Sometimes as humans, we tend to be narrow-minded. We have a narrow circle of friends, a narrow circle of interests. Even our taste buds can be narrow. Well, some of us, some people eat almost anything. But friends, when it came to the salvation of the human race, I praise God that he was not narrow-minded when it came to the salvation of the human race. The Bible says, for God so loved the world. And if that God is our God, if this God is our God, then you and I cannot afford to be narrow-minded when it comes to mission as we walk the narrow way. We must be global Christians with a global vision because our God is a global God. We should be praying like Jabez, Lord, increase my sphere of influence for you. Don't let this ministry stop here. Increase its reach for you. Enlarge my borders. Increase my field of service for you. Give me a concern for others and not just myself. If Jabez had come here, he would have prayed, Lord, give me Georgia. Or maybe even more than that, Lord, give me this country. If he came to Australia, he'd say the same. If he went to Africa, he'd be praying the same. Jabez prayed big, and he asked God to increase his sphere of influence for him. I think of men in history, some great evangelists who did this. On the one here, this guy right here, John Knox, he prayed, Lord, give me Scotland or I die. Next to him, George Whitefield prayed, Lord, give me souls or take my soul. Next to him, Henry Martin arrived on the shores of India, and he exclaimed, here, let me burn out for God. And the man on the far right is a man by the name of John Hyde. If you or I were to draw near to the prayer closet of this man, you would see tears coursing down his cheeks as he knelt beside his bed and prayed, oh Lord, give me souls or I die. And God answered that prayer and gave him thousands. Enlarging our borders, friends, demands vision. It demands faith. It demands effort and work. But listen, Ellen White, she said this, God has given me a message for his people. They must awake, spread their tents, and enlarge their borders. My brethren and sisters, you have been bought with a price, and all that you have and are is to be used to the glory of God and for the good of your fellow men. Christ died on the cross to save the world from perishing in sin. He asks your cooperation in this work. You are to be his helping hand. With earnest, unwearying effort, you are to seek to save the lost. Last July, I was coming home from being at Fountain View Academy in British Columbia, in Canada. Familiar with that? I got to be there for something, I think it was the week of prayer or their graduation, one of the two. And as I was coming home, I came through LA and I was so tired when I hopped on the plane that night. I just wanted to sleep. And every time I travel, I say, Lord, please seat me, if there's someone that I can speak to on this flight, please seat me next to them so that I can talk to them. But when I prayed that prayer on this particular occasion, I didn't pray it very sincerely because I was so tired. I didn't actually want to talk to anybody. So I came and I found my seat and I watched as passengers filed onto the plane. And finally this lady, she came and she sat two seats away from me. She smiled at me and sat down. And I thought, oh, well, she doesn't want to talk either, so I can rest. And you know what? I did rest. I had the best sleep I've ever had on an international flight from LA to Sydney. It's a 14-hour flight, and pretty much I slept 8 hours on that flight, which is unusual for me. We're about an hour and a half out of Sydney, and she leans over and taps me, and she says, excuse me, do you have a pen? I said, oh, yeah, sure. So I reached in my bag and handed her a pen. She said, thank you. And I said, so why are you going to Sydney? She said, oh, well, I'm going to Sydney to meet my first love from 50 years ago. I said, really? She said, yeah. I said, so what's the story? She said, well, I was 15, he was 16. My dad was in the British Army, his dad was in the Australian Army, and they were serving in Singapore. Here we go. We're on. Thank you. All right, so where was I? Okay, yes. So they're in Singapore serving. And basically, they were madly in love. They lived next door to each other. And she even fell pregnant. And just after she fell pregnant, his father was moved. And so she said, my last memory was at the dock. I had one end of the streamer. He had the other end of the streamer. And as the ship left the port, the streamer stretched and snapped. And we cried and cried and cried. That was the last time she saw Ian. I said, wow, it felt like it was a movie, you know. And I said, that's amazing. So what happened? She said, well, life moved on and I met another man. We fell in love, we got married, and we were having a good life. But one day when he was 50, I think she might be about 65, when he was 50, woke up and he was dead in the bed. He'd had a heart attack. And after that, time went on, and as time went on, she started wondering, I wonder what happened to Ian. You see, her son, he lives in England, and all his life, he's been wondering, where is my birth dad? He's even paid people to try and find his birth dad. So she decides that she'll try and find Ian. So she sends an email to the school that they went to in Singapore and asks, do you have any contact details for such and such? They came back and they said, yes, we do. We have an email, but we're not sure if it works. It's old. So she says, well, give it to me. I'll try it. She emails Ian, and Ian responds. What had happened was Ian, too, his life had moved on. He'd met somebody, gotten married, had four kids with this other lady, and then his marriage had just gone to pieces as well and had ended in divorce. And he was also wondering, I wonder what happened to Pat. And so when she emails him and he responds, she said, we just hit it off. It's like we're back in the 1960s again. We just love the same music. We love the same things. It's just so wonderful. She was all giddy about it. And then she said to me, oh, it's just one thing. Long distance is so hard. And I said, yeah, tell me about it. Because I had just saved off my boyfriend in LA. And she said, oh, what's your story? So I started telling her my story. And then along the way, as I'm telling the story, I told her that he's a pastor. She said, oh, you're a Christian. I said, yes, I am. She said, oh, I'm so glad that I'm sitting next to you. She said, because I just had this conversation with Ian. And Ian said to me, he asked me, do you believe in God? I said, yes, I do. She said, well, if that's a problem for you, then we can't be together. We'll just have to call this off. Anyway, she said, I'm going to get to Sydney and we're going to talk about God because I really want to continue this conversation. And I'm thinking, well, I really want to continue this conversation too. So I'm thinking, what should I ask? I said, so have you always been a Christian? She said, no, I haven't. She said, but I was watching the television one day and this Christian program came on. And as I was watching it, this program started talking about how Jesus paid the price for my sin and that I don't have to pay the price for my sin. And when I learned that news, she said, oh, I just broke down in tears and I wanted to run down the street and tell everybody that Jesus had paid it all for me. And she even called the ministry up in tears to tell them that. And I said, oh, that's wonderful. And said, so which church do you go to? And she looked a little bit uncomfortable. She kind of shifted in her seat and she says, oh, well, I've been to lots of different churches. And then she said, what church do you go to? And I thought, well, either you've never been to my church or you have and you didn't like it. So I said to her, well, I'm a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. And she said, she went white, started doing this, and I said, are you okay? You know, I've never had this reaction before. I thought maybe it was a health crisis or something. I started getting worried. She said, oh, I can't believe this, she said. That's the church I've been thinking of joining. I've been praying to God for a sign if I should become a Seventh-day Adventist Christian. She said, when I finish with my trip in Sydney, I'm going to go back to Florida and I'm going to go into the Seventh-day Adventist church. By now, we both wanted to cry. I said, do you mind me asking, but how did you know about the Seventh-day Adventist church? She said, oh, look, I don't know if you know this, but there was this guy on the television. His name was Doug Batchelor. And oh, he's everything he said about the Bible, it made so much sense. She said, he talked about hell, and I understand it. He talked about heaven, and she said, this is so amazing. And I'm sitting there, and I'm amazed too, and I just think to myself, here we are. We've been traveling for nearly over 12 hours, and I've been sleeping the whole time. and my angel and her angel must have been telling my angel, wake her up, because this is a divine appointment. This is an opportunity for enlarging the borders of the kingdom. Wake her up. And so we sat there still a little bit in shock, and then she said, oh, you know what? When the meals came around tonight, I was so interested in having a sausage. She said, but then I remembered that Seventh-day Adventists, they believe that their bodies are the temple of the Holy Spirit. Health is very important. And so she said, I didn't have it. And I said, oh, well, praise the Lord. And then you can see she was all very beautiful there. And as she was, she turned over again and she said, oh, and another thing. She said, while I was sitting here, one of my rings fell off my finger and went under that person's chair over there. I said, oh, did you find it? She said, yes, I found it. But I'm just thinking, maybe that was another sign. Oh, she was so sweet. But you know what? Oh, it's just the most amazing experience on the plane. We talked a little more. She's doing the Bible studies with amazing facts, and she's totally into everything that she can get her hands on. And we talked about Ellen White, and she's going to get a hold of the great controversy. We swapped email addresses. And then when we got to the airport in Sydney, I got my bags, and I kind of hid behind a pillar because I wanted to see this reunion. I don't know what happened to Ian. I think he might have been running late that day or something, or stuck in traffic, so I missed the reunion. But we did email each other after that, and she did go to the church. And again, she said to me, she's just so thankful that she got to sit next to me that day. But God did that. Of all the people in the plane that I could have been sitting next to, God did that. And I share this story with you in the context of this study because I believe that there are people everywhere that God wants to lead us to so that we can point them to Jesus. And they're searching. They're on the borders of the kingdom. It's time for us to enlarge our borders ask God to increase our field of service for Him. So often we look at our limitations and we think it looks like this. Service for God looks like this. My abilities and experience and training and personality and appearance and past and the expectation of others, that's what my assigned territory is. But friends, the Bible says that it is not by might nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord of hosts. So it should look like this. My willingness and weakness plus God's will and supernatural power equals my expanding influence for Him, my expanding territory for Him. Jabez goes on. He says, oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me. What does that mean? He is praying, friends, for God's power to be present in his life. You read the New Testament. It says the hand of the Lord was with them, Acts 11:21, and a great number believed and turned to the Lord. I believe that it was the hand of the Lord, the presence of God, the power of God that was responsible for the exponential growth of the early Christian church. And it will be God who will be responsible for the exponential growth of his remnant last day movement as well. So we need to be praying for power, for God to empower us. I think of this great story of a church in a little country town that caught on fire one night. The alarm went out and everybody lined up, and it was in the days where you passed buckets along to put the fire out. And as they're passing buckets along, there was an elder of the church there, and he noticed that there was a noted atheist in town who was helping them put out the fire. He said, why are you here helping us put out the fire? I mean, we're thankful, but why are you here? You don't even go to this church. He said, I've never seen the church on fire before. The world at its worst needs the church at its best. Amen? We need for God to empower us with his Spirit. Listen to what Vance Havner said. He said, we need a heartwarming. The early Christians did not need a shot in the arm every Sabbath to keep them going. They knew Jesus, and they upset the world and worried the devil and gave wicked rulers insomnia and started something the jails couldn't lock up. Fire couldn't burn, water couldn't drown, swords couldn't kill. You may be little experienced and speak of the dangers of emotion, but we are suffering today from a species of Christianity as dry as dust, as cold as ice, as pale as a corpse, and as dead as King Tut. We are suffering not from a lack of correct heads, but of consumed hearts. Oh, that you and I would be consumed with Jesus, that we would be filled with His Spirit. I think of Spurgeon, one of my favorite preachers of all time, was this great Baptist preacher right here. He was so consumed with Jesus that I read in a biography one night, he broke out into a sermon about Jesus in his sleep. His wife woke up, took notes, handed them to him the next morning, and he went down to the tabernacle and preached it. I think about John Wesley. John Wesley was once asked why so many people would come and hear him preach, and we know he didn't always have it easy. I read to you a page from his diary a couple of days ago. John Wesley said this, "Many years ago, God ignited a fire in my soul, and now people come from all over to watch me burn." Jabez had one last thing that he prayed. He said, "Oh, that you would bless me indeed and enlarge my territory, that your hand would be with me and that you would keep me from evil, that I may not cause pain." Friends, he prayed for protection. Jabez knew that sin would rob him of God's blessings. It would cause his vision to be narrow. It would cause God to have to remove his hand from him. He knew we cannot sin and win. And so he asked God to help him to avoid it, to live above it. And that's how we should be too. Why should this be important? Why should this prayer be important? Because, hide that, that's not meant for you right now. This is important because we represent Jesus. I remember when we were growing up as kids, and sometimes we'd go to somebody's house for lunch, and we'd get to the house, and when we got to the house, my dad would turn the car off, and then he would also lock the doors, and then my parents, their two heads in the front seat, would swing around, and they'd look at my sister and I in the back, and they would proceed to give us a lecture on the things that we couldn't touch when we got inside the house, the family secrets that were to remain family secrets when we got in the house, and how we were to talk. And we were just a little bit irritated that our journey into the house was becoming so slow. And we'd say, "Why? Why do we have to do this?" And I'll never forget what my dad said, "Because you represent us." So as Christians, we should pray for this as well, not only for our own sake, but we represent Jesus to the world. We do not want to give a false representation or misrepresent him to others. And here's a great quote too. "There is nothing that Satan fears so much as that the people of God shall clear the way by removing every hindrance so that the Lord can pour out his Spirit upon a languishing church and an impenitent congregation. When the way is prepared for the Spirit of God, the blessing will come. Wicked men and devils cannot hinder the work of God or shut out his presence from the assemblies of his people. If they will, with subdued, contrite hearts, confess and put away their sins, and in faith claim his promises, every temptation, every opposing influence, whether open or secret, may be successfully resisted, not by might, nor by power, but by my Spirit, says the Lord of hosts." We need to finish here. I've gone over time. But as I think about Jabez, I realize that one of the best parts of his whole prayer is that after he prays all of these things, the Bible tells me that God granted him what he requested. God answers prayer. And as I think about that, I think about Jabez and I think to myself, Jabez, he doesn't light up the book of Acts. He doesn't stand astride the Old Testament like a Moses or an Abraham or a Joshua. He is what I call the Bible's little big man. But it was that little extra that made the difference for him. And he was just an ordinary person who placed his life in the hands of an extraordinary God. And God was able to do great things with him. You may think that your existence is insignificant at times, especially when you consider the fact that you are just one of the rest of the however many 7 billion other people on this planet. But friends, when we put God into that picture, suddenly things change. Suddenly we have potential. Suddenly we have a purpose because we serve a powerful God who goes beyond us. A God who, when we resist him, he loves past our defenses. A God who with him, little is much. And if we will just put our hand in the hand of God. It is power on with God. Little is much. And I pray that that's something you will file away in your hearts as you go home as well. When you feel like your ministry is small, little is much when God is in it. Let us pray. Our loving Father in heaven, thank you for the prayer of Jabez here. We thank you, Lord, that you're a God who delights to bless us. Please bless us. We pray, Lord, that you would help us to enlarge our territory for you, to expand. We pray that you would expand our sphere of influence for you. We pray, Lord, that your hand would be with us, that you would empower us to do for you what you are calling us to do and to live and be what you are calling us to be at this time in Earth's history. And Lord, we pray that you would keep us from evil, that we might represent you aright to the world around us because we know you are coming soon. And thank you, Lord, that this is a prayer that you delight to answer. You long to answer it, and you will answer it because this afternoon we are not asking it because we feel we are worthy. We ask it because we believe in Jesus. We know that he is worthy, and we ask it in his name. Amen.